Pre-industrial levels of atmospheric CO2 were around 275 parts per million, and they're presently in the order of 419 or 420, which is way, way above the regarded safe threshold of 350 parts per million. And atmospheric methane, I think, is around 30% higher than it was in pre-industrial times and makes up around about a third of the radiative forcing of the anthropogenic gases in the atmosphere. So the idea of restoring the climate is to, by some means, to withdraw or pull or draw down the around a trillion or so tons of CO2, which is in the atmosphere and the ocean, which shouldn't be there, by mid-century, and to have a similar impact on reducing atmospheric methane levels. In so doing, bringing the atmospheric conditions back to the way they were pre-industrial, and all of this done in the next 28 years. That's broadly what climate restoration is, Peter?
Yeah.
So the first question that we've got out of three is that even possible? Is it technically and scientifically possible? Michael, what would your view on that be from your reading?
Well, yeah, and I realized I didn't intentionally do this. I didn't mean to sidestep your question of where I am on what you called the doom, gloom, or bloom scale, in part because I rejected that that way of framing it. But in any case, yeah, because ecology really is so foundational for me in ways that it wasn't for my, you know, two decades or longer of being an evolutionary evangelist. At that point, I interpreted evolution in a much more progressive and human-centered way that I now reject. And so do I believe that climate restoration is possible? No. Am I grateful that there's people like Peter working on it? Absolutely. So essentially, I see sort of, because the main thing I've studied in the last, 9 years is the rise and fall of civilizations, and that we don't have a single example of any human-centered civilization, that is, civilizations that are extractive and exploitative rather than preservative, that cultures that are genuinely sustainable, the one thing they have in common is they preserve the well-being of the biosphere and the systems that make their life possible, the soil, the forest, the water, the life, all that stuff. And so we don't have any example of a civilization that's been human-centered, that's been extractive and exploitative, becoming sustainable. It can't be done for very well-known physical reasons. And yet, the main thing that I think is important, because I believe that we're in an unstoppable, accelerating process of collapse, and that we're going to experience horrific suffering, and yet, what do people wake up and do? How do they spend their time? So I'm encouraging people to spend their time and energy and heart and mind energy on anything and everything regenerative and restorative, and anything that builds trust and community at the local levels. And so am I grateful for, the people like Peter and Paul Hawken and others who are doing regenerative, restorative, Joe Brewer, one of my dear brothers in the field of regeneration. Am I grateful that those folks are doing that? Absolutely. Do I think any of that has a chance of saving industrial civilization? No. But is it holy work anyway? Yes, absolutely. So I'm sort of in a weird place. I'm definitely not a doomer. I'm a post-doomer, which you got to experience a little bit of doom to get to post-doom. But I live my life in a place of joy and compassionate, generous contribution as best I can, given my gifts and my limitations. And I'm honored to communicate with and build friendships and collegial relationships with people across the spectrum, some of whom agree with me on a lot, some of them agree on some, but our disagreements, in my experience, are far more interesting than our agreements. And I have sort of an ecosystem view or a body view. I mean, I don't want my heart cells and my anal sphincter cells to be doing the same thing. The fact that they're playing different roles is essential for the health of my body. And the fact that different of us are doing different things in this body who share a common heart for a positive future or a healthy future, if that's possible, but nonetheless have an ecocentric or biocentric heart. I'm like, let's hold hands, support each other. And where we differ, cool. These things happen.
Just for the record, I don't want you to, your heart and your sphincter to have the same role either. But thanks for sharing that. I'll try not to think about that too much.
And I'll be happy to own that I'm the anal sphincter cell. You guys can be the heart cell.
Peter, can you bring some? Can you say something, please?
Yeah, that, Michael, that's great. I love your answer because. In the scientific community, most people agree with you that it's just not possible. And the evidence given is very similar to what you provide. It's like, you know what? This is what happens. And there ain't no recovering from the decline that we're heading into. And and it's certainly the case that when we get out of it, and we're getting out of it, we're going to be a very different society. So the thing that science can't do, you know, science is built on predicting the future. You know, if I toss a ball, there's a predictable, almost certain arc that it's going to take. And yeah, the wind will blow it a little to the left or something like that. But there's a predictable, almost certain future. On the other hand, I could toss a ball and call my dog to catch it or something, right? There are things that happen that aren't predictable, but they can be caused in language. If I don't catch my dog's attention, he's probably not going to catch or deflect the ball. And so there's a created future, which we can create in our speaking together. And that's what climate restoration is. It's totally not predictable. And if you're constrained, as most classical scientists are, if you're constrained to what's known, it is impossible. Now, so was going to the moon, right? So when John Kennedy in 1961 said, we're going to land a man on the moon and bring him back safely by the end of the decade, the scientists, I was only six, so I didn't ask. I assume the scientists were up in arms. They would have to be, because there was no evidence that we were going to do that. We didn't have the rockets, the radios, the life support, the batteries, the navigation. None of that existed. Clearly, it was impossible, because scientifically, there's, you know, the predictable future was not going to the moon. And it happened because John Kennedy said, you know what, we're going to do it. And he enrolled millions of people in creating the miracles, the unpredictable outcomes that had happened. So climate restoration is one of those where the trick is this, and I love your talking about technological society, or I don't remember if that's exactly the word you used, but when Michel Foucault, the French philosopher, wrote about different periods in humanity, and the way we look at reality depends on just the lens we look at. You know, normally we think reality is reality. This is a pen, right? But if you've never written, it's a piece of plastic, and or just a stick. And so, in classic times, in Renaissance times, it was all about God, and everything was. If you look at the liturgy and writings from hundreds of years ago, it was about God. Then it was about nature. Nature became what everyone wanted to learn about, species and all the different kinds of flowers and bees and so on. And then in the last 200 years, it's become about man and our thoughts and about progress. Well, the next, the term that Foucault uses is episteme. So the next episteme is about humanity as a whole. And it makes sense because we're now one humanity. That is, we rise and fall together. It used to be when the Roman Empire fell, okay, then some other empire or nation took over. You know, if the Navajo fell, then another tribe took over. No big deal. It had been going on like that for millions of years, or however many years. And no longer. When we fall, curtains, and it's back to the cockroaches. And so now we get to know our future, not from the perspective of my thoughts or technology. We can know the future from the perspective of humanity as a whole for the first time in the history of our planet. And so now what that gives you, Michael, is a whole, rather than going into a technological society, we're going into a human-based, a future-based society where because we have the technology available, we can actually, you know, get the CO2 out of the atmosphere. We can get restore a population that our planet can hold while we travel and do the things we humans love to do, and keep people healthy and happy. We can talk about happy, but we're going to run out of time before we do that. but it's a different future. And then the cool thing is, and the work that the three of us have to do and the people who are listening is actually start creating that future in our thinking. Like, oh yeah, you know, what I really want for my grandkids is a world where the climate is one that sustains agriculture like it did the last 10,000 years, where the planet sustains the population we have so we're not extincting animals and vegetables all the time like we are now, but get back to that lower population where the evolution could match our de-evolution, our extinction. And once you start, and everyone's healthy, obviously people will get born, and they will get older, and they will eventually die. But that's part of thriving, of flourishing, that whole life cycle. And if you think of the life cycle as healthy, you know, from birth to maturity and then withering, then you actually start seeing that this future that's, I think you might agree, is exactly the one I want for our grandkids. And by the way, my grandson's also two.
Oh, sweet. So while I don't share your faith or your belief about what's possible, I don't, largely because of what I've spent the last 9 years studying, which is that some of the fundamental differences between truly sustainable cultures, that is cultures that that reliably don't go into the overshoot bust pattern, the cultures that preserve the well-being of the soil, the forest, the water, the life upon which they depend with religious ferocity. And those cultures that reliably overshoot the carrying capacity, both the biological carrying capacity and the social, you know, it's psychological carrying capacity, human nature carrying capacity, which happens in larger groups than tribes typically. And so I personally don't, what I tend to focus on, and first of all, I got to say that the piece that I align with you on very deeply is the power of language individually and collectively to co-create our experience of reality and to shape human intention and will. Philosophy of language, in all of my graduate and undergraduate work, my single favorite course was philosophy of language. And yet, what I find myself focusing on, at least in these last 9 years, are what are those dimensions of reality or aspects of reality that truly transcend human will, human language, and human anything, for that matter. What are those things that will occur regardless of if 8 billion of us died tonight in our sleep, or if 8 billion of us woke up tomorrow morning as eco-saints, committed to doing the right thing in every possible way? What are those dimensions? And it seems to me that there are certain things that are so unstoppable now, such as the forests of the world. Evidentially, we're clearly in the great conflagration of the world's forests. We're in the great loss of the world's ice. Now, is it possible that if the kinds of things that you envision truly, if the leaders of the world and millions of people are in support of, you know, the kinds of biomimicry, especially some of the natural or more biomimicry approach, sequestration of carbon and methane that you envision, could that offset some of these things that I'm now saying are unstoppable? Possibly. I want to certainly be open to that. But I see the loss. It seems to me that we are in, well, the main thing I'd say is that we are in a situation where one of the things we learn from the rise and fall of literally scores of previous civilizations is that most people never wake up and get it. Most people stay in denial, the full scale. And so I don't see a collective mass or a social tipping point or enough of the leadership and the populations of the world aligning to make the collective we, like if we do this or we do that, or if only we, you know, I just don't see that happening. I think that's beyond the realm of possibility in terms of human psychology, given the corruption and the economic dysfunction, corruption that is always present in every collapsed civilization.